Respected resource person, Dr. P. Varalakshmi, faculty members, most valued participants from all over the world, and my dear students. Once more, welcome to the third day of our international e-conference on recent trends in nanotechnology and material sciences. Today, we have with us an eminent scientist who will take us on nanocatalyst for biodiesel production from microalgae. She is currently the assistant professor, Department of Molecular Microbiology, School of Biotechnology, Madurai Kamaraj University, Tamil Nadu, India. Her research interests include biofuels from microalgae, nanoscience for biofuels, metabolic engineering for bioproducts from microalgae, etc. I'd like to mention a few awards received by her as well. She has received DST Young Scientist Award 2012 and was selected as the Outstanding Women Award for the year 2018 by Venus International Foundation, Chennai. Appreciation Award for research contribution during 2016-17 and Outstanding Reviewer Award from Food and Bioproducts Processing Elsevier Publications 2015. She has published numerous papers in international journals and also has many patents to her credit. She has been the resource person in various conferences. She is a reviewer and member of the editorial board of many peer-reviewed journals. She is a member of many professional bodies and has received national and international research projects and collaborations. Ma'am, we are really honored with your esteemed presence. I'm sure this session will provide great insights and enhance our knowledge in this area. Ma'am, on behalf of the Postgraduate Department of Physics, St. Joseph's College for Women, I cordially welcome you to this conference.
Thank you so much for your nice introduction. Once again, I'd like to thank Dr. Maurice Marley for inviting me to deliver a talk on this international conference, especially on nanocatalyst or nanomaterial for the production of biofuels from microalgae. And thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. This is a different topic for the students, because for the past 2 days they are listening the talk entirely from a new from their traditional physics and advanced physics too. But it is anyway, both all the topics whatever they have listened is purely from physics. But now I am going to deliver a talk on a mixed topic on biofuel production using nanomaterials. So my today's topic is nanocatalyst for biodiesel production from microalgae. Actually, I paid attention on my biodiesel production from microalgae because biodiesel is one of the alternate energy to replace the petrol diesel, because we all know that energy and clean air among the most important human needs and are very essential to socioeconomic prosperity. Because of this burgeoning population and industrialization and urbanization have resulted in ever increasing demand for the energy and clean air. And we all know that the fossil fuels are the world's primary source of energy, but their availability is very less. Nowadays, it has been the fossil fuel usage and the availability of fossil fuel is decreasing or declining, and so people are paying more attention on the production of or searching some other alternative fuel to petrol fuels. So if you look at the market, the biodiesel production has increased from 23.6 billion liters to nearly 30.5 billion from the year 2012 to till now. There are some top three investors are there. They are producing this biodiesel. America, Germany, Brazil are the top three investors. They are producing biodiesel by using different feedstock like plants and algae too. So usually the biodiesel, what is biodiesel? Biodiesel may be defined as a fuel which may comprised of monoalkyl esters, and which are otherwise we can say they may have medium and long chain fatty acids, which may be derived from the biological sources, that too from vegetable oil, animal fats and other sources, means edible oil and non-edible oil that obtained from the plant feedstocks. So this the use of this socio-economic this biodiesel can be a diesel substitute in future, and it can we can promote this alternate energy to replace the petrol diesel, and we can grow this kind of biodiesel feedstock like algae and plant at our home, and even we can start a small enterprise to produce more amount of biomass, and we can produce from the biomass to biodiesel for their own use in the future. Unless otherwise, if you define a proper or simplest technology to extract the lipids and the conversion of lipids into biodiesel, that is the main bottleneck to convert biomass to biodiesel by using simplest technology. At the same time, we need to focus on the cost effectiveness of the production of the biodiesel. Okay, so we have to think about this alternate energy for reducing this environmental pollution also, because while you are consuming this petrol diesel, we all know that for all transportation and industrial stress sectors, we are using this diesel or petrol diesel for the combustion purpose, and simultaneously they are liberating this fuel into the atmosphere. Thereby, it leads to cause the accumulation of carbon dioxide and other obnoxious gases in the atmosphere, which leads to cause the greenhouse effect. So, ma'am, we need to,
Lakshmi ma'am, sorry for the inconvenience.
Yes.
Ma'am, your slides are not changing.
Yeah, I'm just talking first, then only I will go for the next slide.
Okay, ma'am, thank you.
Are you able to hear my voice properly?
Yeah, voice is clear. Slides were not changing, that's why. Thank you, ma'am.
No problem. I will give you the introduction about why we have to focus on biodiesel. So I'm just talking.
Okay, ma'am. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you. So it is very important. We have to focus on renewable energy sources. One among the renewable energy sources are microalgae, plants, and etc. Because we can cultivate more amount of plants and microalgae in your land area, and we can get this biodiesel out of it. But only the difference between the plants and microalgae cultivation is depends upon the area how we are going to occupy, because usually the land which is used for the cultivation of plant, I think people might have known about the biodiesel would be produced from jatropha as the only plant. So the jatropha can be replaced by this microalgae, because in the microalgae cultivation it needs a small quantity of area, and within that we can produce a huge amount of biodiesel. So what I'm trying to say is biodiesel can be produced from this microalgae for the better use of or better replacement of petrol diesel in future. Okay. And one more thing is very important. I already told you this petrol diesel is emitting the carbon dioxide and into the atmosphere, and thereby it leads to cause greenhouse effect. But in the case of biodiesel, it is composed of only 10-11% of oxygen, and there is no or least amount of carbon monoxide and trace amounts of nitrogen, and it is sulfur free. So the oxygen content of the biodiesel can improve the combustion efficiency of the engines also. That way it may reduce the fuel oxidation potential. So that is the reason why people are searching for this biodiesel could be an alternative choice for petrol diesel usage. Okay. And why I already told you why we have to choose biodiesel, because of the liberation of this carbon dioxide from the industries and the polluted environment. For example, in USA, Europe, India and China, they are liberating this carbon dioxide from their industries among at least 61% when you are comparing with global level. So, and simultaneously, on the other hand, 11 billion tons of industrial waste are released into the water reservoirs. So what has happened, the shrinkage of so the carbon dioxide emission and the pollution in the water reservoirs and the other side, the depletion of petrodiesel, it may lead to cause in complete depletion of the petrodiesel in the year 2050. Okay, so this is the end of the fossil fuel. It was predicted by Meitei et al. In the year 2014. So why is why we have to focus on this industrial waste? There is no correlation between this carbon dioxide emission and the river contamination. There are some interlink actually. The carbon dioxide emission could be caused greenhouse gas emission, but in the case of industrial waste liberated into the rivers, which may cause the damage to the river bodies. At the same time, the industrial waste can be used for the cultivation of the feedstock of microalgae. So simultaneously, we can remediate and we can treat the wastewater and we can get the biomass, and that biomass could be used for the production of fuel. That way you can limit the emission of carbon dioxide in future. So we have started in India, we have started the biodiesel engine. Shri Umesh Singh, AGM, he has inaugurated the first biodiesel locomotive on SCR Secunderabad in the year 2014. And we have some biodiesel power plant, and we have used the Jatropha biodiesel obtained from the Jatropha. It was blended with some amount of diesel. It has been operated. The rail has been, the train has been operated in the year 2015 by using this biodiesel, but still it is in the, what is that, under the preparative stage. It has not been commercialized in India. Coming to the point, biofuels, we have to know about what are the types of biofuel. There are three types, we can say: bioethanol, biooil, biodiesel. They are the substitute of different categories. Bioethanol is gasoline substitute. Biooil or pure plantation oil can be the substitute for kerosene, and biodiesel would be the diesel fuel substitute. So the biofuels can be produced from various feedstock. When you see here, the corn, soya, sunflower and rapeseed palm, and algae are the major feedstock for the production of biofuels. And the algae, it ranks first for the production of biodiesel because it can be produced 10,000 to 200,000 gallon per hectare. Okay, so the biofuels, these are the biofuels. The three types of biofuels can be produced from different feedstock. I already told you the biofuel feedstock can do the carbon dioxide mitigation, and they can utilize the industrial waste which was released from different kinds of industry, maybe the solid or it may be a liquid waste, can be used as a substitute for the growth of this biofuel feedstock. And other cheap nutrient sources can also be used to cultivate this biodiesel feedstock. Then what are the biofuel feedstock? Already we have seen in the previous slide, similarly the soybean, the corn, sunflower, rapeseed, jatropha and jojoba. The others, on the other side, the primitive plants or the eukaryotic and prokaryotic, very tiny microorganisms or microalgae and cyanobacteria. So by utilizing all the three things, and from the atmosphere and the land environment or from the river water bodies, these biofuel feedstock would able to give the biofuel and value added products. So these are the important feedstock for biodiesel production. So microbial oils, yeast, fungi, microalgae and bacteria, and you can use the waste and the seed oils, whatever we have seen in the past two slides. So why we have to use this microalgae when apart from the other feedstock is the microalgae, or you can see these are the microalgae cannot be able to see your naked eye as a single cell, but it can be seen through the microscope. But you can see this microalgae or the algae in waterlogging area. You can see some green color mat will be appeared on the river and some waterlogging area pond, even in the seashore and sea also you can see this algae. They are phototrophic organisms. Sometimes even in the absence of light, they can also able to grow. So that can be involved in heterotrophic mode also. These are the algae are easily cultivable, and it can be grown in wastewater, and it has been giving very low calorific value and viscosity is also very less, and no or least carbon dioxide emission, and it which will be reducing the greenhouse effect, and they will do carbon dioxide fixation by thereby they will be mitigating the carbon dioxide, and the scale up would be very easy. So far more than 40,000 species of this kind of algae has been identified all over the world. So what is the mechanism of this algae, how it is growing? By taking the light energy from the sun, the photon is the energy source for this algae, and they will be utilizing the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and simultaneously they will be releasing the oxygen. When they involved in metabolic process, they have the ability to synthesize the acids and fatty acids, and simultaneously they will be releasing the nutrients which are essential for their growth. And simultaneously they will be treating, if the water is where they are growing, for their growth it needs some amount of water. The water may be contaminated with pollutant, any inorganic or organic sources can be polluted. If it is present as a pollutant, this microalgae will comfortably grow, and they will be removing the toxic substances in the wastewater, and simultaneously they will be treating. So by growing this algae in a waterlogging condition, if it is contaminated, no matter at all, they will be doing the carbon dioxide fixation, and they will be releasing the carbon oxygen, and simultaneously they will be giving the oils and fatty acids that are essential for the conversion of or the production of diesel, and simultaneously they will be doing this wastewater treatment. So that is the reason why people have chosen this microalgae would be the right choice for the alternative energy production, one of the right choice. So when coming to the point, types of fatty acids means the fatty acids which is accumulated in the algae. We should know what are the types of fatty acid and why it is essential, and what type of fatty acids can be used as a fuel. So generally the types of fatty acids can be classified based on the three categories: the length of the carbon chain, it could be long chain, medium chain and short chain, and based on the degree of unsaturation it could be classified into two categories: saturated, unsaturated. And based on the location of double bonds, it could be classified into omega-3, omega-6 and omega-9. So based on the saturation, it could be SFA saturated fatty acid, monounsaturated fatty acid and polyunsaturated fatty acid. The difference between saturated and monounsaturated and polyunsaturated, where how many numbers of double bonds and has been present, and and further, the saturated fatty acids can be classified into a long chain, medium chain and short chain fatty acid. For biodiesel production, these two chains of saturated fatty acids would be essential: long chain and medium chain fatty acids. And short chain fatty acids can be used for aviation fuel, and PFOA can be considered as nutraceuticals because based on the double bond where it is existed, it could be classified as omega-3, omega-6 and omega-9. So I already told you these are the points of where the double bonds are existed, omega-3 and omega-6, example of PFOA, polyunsaturated fatty acid. So medium chain fatty acids, the saturated medium chain fatty acids starting from C12 to C18, monounsaturated, are highly suitable for biodiesel production. And very short chain fatty acids, C4 to C10, has low cetane number, and it can be used as avian fuel, means the jet fuel, for example in alkanes. An optimum chain length would be for C12 to 18 for biodiesel. So when coming to the point, the algae have people, why are they are paying attention on this algae? Is majorly the algae can able to fix the carbon dioxide. So they will do the carbon dioxide assimilation. According to Sapphire Energy Incorporation San Diego, they reported that 1 kg of algae assimilates 1.8 kg of carbon dioxide. So if the oil content which is present in the algae while they are growing, so 1 kg of oil can be obtained from 2 kg of algal biomass. So totally, if it is 6.8 kg of algae can yield 3.4 kg. Means 1 gallon of oil. So this 6.8 kg of algae would assimilate 12 to 13 kg of carbon dioxide, and thereby they will be yielding 3.4 kg of oil by using this photosynthetic mechanism, and simultaneously they can able to metabolize this organic carbon dioxide capture and inorganic carbon dioxide capture, and simultaneously they may utilize whatever the compounds which may be present in the water can be utilized for their better growth, and they will do this process, carbon dioxide fixation. So that way this algae can reduce the carbon dioxide emission wherever you are going to grow this culture. mostly people have used this microalgae in open pond method, open raised phase pond. So there, this microalgae can take up this carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. There are some closed large scale bioreactors are also available to cultivate this microalgae. For example, these are tubular photobioreactors. This is hanging gardens. You can grow this microalgae in a large scale. And now I told you open raised phase ponds are also being used to cultivate this microalgae. These are all open raised phase ponds. This is tubular photobioreactor. In a lab condition, you can scale up this microalgae by using conical flask and small boxes. Okay. These are some example for large scale production of this algal biomass, because biomass is directly proportional to the conversion of biofuel, because whatever the biomass is present in the environment, if they are able to accumulate the lipid, definitely that lipid would be converted into fatty acid, and that fatty acid is esterified further, it can be used for biodiesel purpose. So this is the biodiesel chemical composition of biodiesel. Generally, the microalgae, they have the ability to accumulate the triglyceride in their body when they are normally grown in nutrient conditions. But generally, the microalgae, the eukaryotic algae, whenever they are present, whenever they are growing in a condition, if it is fully having a luxurious nutrients, definitely they will undergo the biomass production. But there are many reports are stating that when this microalgae, when they are in starved condition, at that time they will not go for further cell division, and they will start to synthesize the fatty acid. In order to acclimatize the conditions, the microalgae can be able to synthesize the carbon. So carbon switchover will be happen during that time. They can be able to accumulate the triglycerides. So these triglycerides can be converted into fatty acid methyl esters by the help of this methanol and sodium hydroxide. So the byproduct would be always the glycerol. So this microalgae cats are algae, either it is maybe cyanobacteria or other microalgae, can produce this lipids, and further it could be converted into fatty acid methyl esters. They are known as the biodiesel. So since it is in lab scale, you will be getting a small quantity. Even if you go for large quantity, this biodiesel can be blended with the petrodiesel. So we can commercially we can produce B5, B2, B5, B20, B18, B100 blends are commercialized. B100 is right choice because B100 is purely 100% biodiesel, which does not having any combination of petrodiesel. So it will be reducing the carbon dioxide more than 75% than the petrodiesel. And they also have very less or low sulfur content. For example, the petrodiesel will be having 500 ppm, but in the case of biodiesel, it is lesser than that. So usually what we do, the microalgae can be collected from any of the area. I think this is the site of culture collection. For example, you might have seen whenever you are walking around the waterlogging area, you can see this algae. You can collect the algae and we can grow in your lab by using the culture conditions. We have to grow a separate, we have to provide new nutrients for cultivating this algae. That name of the media is BG11. If you can provide 25 degree centigrade under constant illumination or alternate photo period, definitely this algae will comfortably grow, and we can take up this algae and further we can go for scale-up studies, and then we can allow the cells for starvation, then we can extract the lipids. And this is other site of sample collection. It is nearby Ramnath, Yamseri. We have collected this algae. This is one of the red algae. The previous one is green algae. Actually, this is also a green algae. When they are in nutrient starved condition, extreme summer, we have seen this green algae turn into green, turn into red, because of one kind of lipid derivatives has been accumulated in the algae. It is known as carotenoids. You might have seen this carotenoids in carrot and pumpkin, etc. This algae also, they do accumulate this carotenoids, and that is the reason why this pond has become red. You might have hear some of the daily newspaper has releases the news about a pond has been suddenly changed into red color. This is only because of the growth of the algae that has accumulated the lipid derivative or the pigments, beta carotenoids, inside the cells. That is the reason the pond has become red in color. So we have collected the sample from this pond with our research scholars. We went there and we have collected, and some of the algae from the pond where we have gone, we have isolated and identified these are the algae. By collecting 1 gram of water from the sample, we can get plenty of microalgae, plenty of individual microalgae and filamentous algae from that. And these are the list of algae we identified from the different sites of sample collected areas. For example, Oscillatoria, Microcoleus, Cynicocystis, and Eptolimbia, like that we have identified. These are the microscopic observation of individual cells of the microalgae by atomic fluorescent microscopy. And this is one of the other type of microalgae, namely Chlorella. This type of algae is commercially used for the production of biofuel. And this is another type of microalgae. Naturally, it is releasing this lipid while using microalgae, for example, Potriococcus. So this is the only microalgae which is naturally releasing this accumulated lipid. You can see the water oil droplets inside the body of the algae. It when it is accumulated, and it will be releasing, it will be oozing out this algae. But the other algae, it will not ooze out the accumulated lipid out. So we need to extract the lipids by employing different kinds of solvents and other machineries to extract this lipid from the cells. So from the cells, we used to extract the lipids apart from the Botryococcus. Apart from this Botryococcus, we extract the lipids. Before that, we must check the cells, whether the cells really accumulating the lipids or not. So we have gone for nitride staining by using this confocal microscopy. We came to know that whenever the cells accumulated the lipids will become fluorescent color when we fix with the dye, so-called nitride. So the oil bodies inside the cell will be appeared as yellow fluorescence, and then we can go for the lipid extraction. These are the some of the algae which can able to accumulate the lipids. So you can clearly see the lipids which were accumulated inside the algal cells. So once we confirmed through this nitride staining, yeah, this algae is accumulating the lipid, next step is we have to go for extraction. So apart from the morphology of this algae, we can use some molecular tools to identify the algae. So these are the tools we routinely use to identify the algae. Then in our lab, after this identification of we can raise the biomass by slowly, we have to cultivate this algae from the plate, and we have to transfer this culture into tubes, and we have to raise the biomass from 5 ml to 50 ml. Here one loophole you have to check, and then it should be grown in 5 ml, then here 100 ml, then 500 ml, then we can go for 10 liters. Likewise, you have to scale up the biomass because you have to get huge amount of biodiesel. This is what we are doing in our lab. So once this accumulated lipids has been accumulated inside the cells, we need to go for extraction. There are different kinds of extractions are there. We can use microwave irradiation, ultrasonication, electrophoration, and liquid nitrogen and homogenization. These are the methods are used for lipid extraction from the microalgae. So there are these methods are expensive, so most of the people will go for the solvent usage, that too green solvent, that should not affect the environment also. Okay, so here it is very important to say, here one method is missing, that the extraction can be done with nanomaterial. It will be coming in the later slides. So based on the foresight methods, we have extracted the lipids, and we identified some of the species has been accumulated more amount of lipid, starting from for example, Cynicocystis, one species of cyanobacteria. It has the tendency to accumulate the lipid 16%, and in the case of Myxosarcina, it has been accumulated only 13.6% of lipid. There are many strategies to improve the lipid content in the microalgae. Biologically we do in our lab, and if you want to go for the large scale production, that also can be done. I already told you whether we can employ this nutrient starvation, or else we can employ different kinds of stresses. Even magnetic field is one of the stress can be employed to the algal cells in order to get more amount of lipid. We have demonstrated in our lab, but data here I didn't show the data. So what is the overall biodiesel production from the biomass, either plant or algae? For example, biomass would be the microorganism or vegetable oil. There are some spilling stick or waste oil. We have to go for transesterification by using any acid or base catalyst in addition with the solvents, methanol and ethanol. The catalyst may be the homogeneous catalyst or in combination of other heterogeneous also. In homogeneous catalyst, either alkaline or acid. And here heterogeneous also alkaline in combination with other heterogeneous mode also we can use acid and other enzymatic. And finally, you'll be getting the biodiesel. So really, that's also for I have discussed about the microalgae and how these are the algae are being used for the accumulation. What are the conditions are required for the growth of microalgae? We have discussed, and now we are going to see about the nanocatalyst are being employed for this biodiesel productions. So for nanocatalyst, there are different types of nanocatalysts generally. You might have heard base nanocatalyst, acid nanocatalyst, bio nanocatalyst, and the feedstock would be the renewable feedstock. And what is the importance of this nanocatalyst generally? They will have high activities and they have unique properties, and we need to pay attention on preparation methods also. Finally, by employing this nanocatalyst, you can get biodiesel from the renewable oil feedstock. So catalyst, you might have heard about the word catalyst, simply defined as it can be it can speed up the reactions, whatever the reaction you are going to perform. If you can employ this catalyst, definitely it will be speed up the reaction. So it will increase the rate of reaction rate, and we can get means the transesterification reaction rate if you are going to employ the catalyst for the conversion of dry glyceride into fatty acid methyl esters. So homogeneous catalyst, normally what type of homogeneous catalyst are being employed for biodiesel production? Strong alkali catalyst, example sodium hydroxide, sodium methoxide and potassium hydroxide, and alkali metal hydroxide were also used, and they are more active according to our experience. And sometimes some of the drawbacks may be found by using this alkali catalyst because of the formation of soap, and it will be reacting with the vegetable oils and free fatty acids. So in order to overcome this problem, acid catalyst can also be used. And nowadays we can use the combination of acid and alkali catalyst for the transesterification. And so acid catalyst generally sulfuric acid, phosphoric acid, sulfonic acid and hydrochloric acid are also used. In our lab we are focusing on only hydrochloric acid and this alkali catalyst in addition with the nanocatalyst. So what is the advantage of this homogeneous catalyst and heterogeneous catalyst? First, we can have some points about this homogeneous catalyst. Advantages of this homogeneous catalyst are they are highly selective. The turnover frequency is very higher, and reaction rate and for optimization, it is very easy. Disadvantages is cost consuming. Still, it is not economical, and regeneration is also not possible. So choosing heterogeneous catalyst only because of minimizing the additional step carried out in the homogeneous catalyst. And other important point is it is very easy to recover this catalyst, and this catalyst can increase the recovery of FAME, and maybe it is less costly. Okay. And this heterogeneous catalyst may withstand if you are going to employ different conditions like heat and temperature, and they are highly selective and highly efficient catalyst. And this catalyst can be easily recovered from the reactions. Okay. Apart from that, why don't we use this heterogeneous nanocatalyst? People have started to use this heterogeneous nanocatalyst. There are some other catalysts are also biologically synthesized from the algae, plant and other macroalgae, even some bacteria and fungi are also being used to synthesize this nanocatalyst. Okay, even if you can synthesize this nanocatalyst from the waste, for example, peels, woods, coconut shells and some other sugarcane bagasse, etc. can be used for the production of this nanocatalyst. And we are now strongly focusing on the carbocatalyst from algae. It is from micro and macro algae. Apart from that, sulfonated acid supported graphene containing highly accessible active acidic sites can also be used because which can strongly bind to the stable and insoluble efficient biodiesel production, because they can strongly bind to the the lipids. Okay, whatever the lipids which are going to be added to the reactions can be interacted very fastly. So these are the points about this nanocatalyst, why we have chosen this nanocatalyst for our studies. Okay, so recovery mode, majorly we have focused on recovery of catalyst when the system is most important, because we can easily recover it and we can reuse this nanocatalyst for further studies also. And the major point is we have to consider, because the nano size, the high surface area will be there, so thereby they will be increasing the contact between the reactants and the catalyst, so automatically the transesterification reaction will be increased. Okay, so some important nanocatalysts are being used for biodiesel production. For example, metal oxides based nanocatalyst is zeolites and nanolites, and nanohydrotoluides and magnetic nanocatalysts are best example for nanocatalyst for biodiesel production. This is just a schematic view of this biodiesel production by using this copper doped zinc oxide. This is copper ions and zinc ions doping, and you will be getting this nanocatalyst with methanol. So neem oil is the feedstock for the conversion of biodiesel production. So we have to add, we have to proceed with the transesterification reaction by using this copper doped zinc oxide nanocatalyst, and finally you will be getting the biodiesel. This is the overview of nanocatalyst for the production of biodiesel. The feedstock can be any oil feedstock, but in our study we have used the microalgae as the feedstock, and we have employed the nanoparticle which is also synthesized from the biosources. For example, we have synthesized the calcium oxide from the shells. We have collected the shells from the scissor area and we have powdered it, and we have pyrolyzed this calcium oxide, and finally we have got the powder of calcium oxide. And at the same time we have synthesized calcium carbonate, and both the synthesized material was analyzed for structural elucidation, and we have analyzed through semi images, and we found out the characteristics of this nanocatalyst, and we have gone some beta analysis in order to identify the pore size and pore volume of this catalyst also. And this catalyst was employed to different types of lipids which is obtained from different conditions employed to the microalgae, means the microalgae grown in different conditions. So we have collected the cells and we obtained the lipid from the normal cells, wherein we have employed only the acid catalyst, meaning the hydrochloric acid. But in the case of the algae and the lipids which is collected from the algae, wherein we have employed, instead of acid catalyst, we have employed the nano TiO2, the photocatalyst. Titanium oxide is the photocatalyst which is commercially available. We have used the commercial nanocatalyst, and here we have employed both the catalysts. For example, the bio-nano calcium oxide and calcium carbonate, both the catalysts were synthesized from the biological source, and we have employed these two catalysts to the microalgal lipid, and we quantified the fame from the lipid which is obtained from the algae, and that was compared with acid catalyst and the commercially available titanium oxide. We have obtained the fame recovery is more than the control and the commercial TiO2. Okay, so this is the data of the fatty acid which is obtained from, or the fame which is obtained by employing different types of catalyst. For example, in control we have employed the acid catalyst. We have got C16 is to 3 and C18 is to 1. When compared with this control, means there is no addition of this nanocatalyst, that titanium oxide have been given somewhat more than the control. Means acid catalyst 18.8, here somewhat similar, but in case slightly it has been reduced. But in the case of the catalyst, nanocatalyst which we have synthesized from the biological source, have been yielded a good amount of fatty acid methyl esters when compared with the acid catalyst. And we have synthesized the bio-nanoparticles, the heterogeneous catalyst for biodiesel production, okay, from the macroalgae. And Here, these are the algae. We have chosen one of the brown algae, Isocaris and Phaeodactylum, and we have grown this algae by using the waste. It is rice husk and urea, and we have employed a different types of stress to the algae in order to accumulate the lipid, the magnetic stress, as well as the heterotrophic cultivation means without giving the light, because the algae are phototrophic organs and they need sunlight, and some of the algae they can grow even in the absence of light. But that is the reason why we have protected, we have covered the flask with the aluminium foil in order to prevent the entry of light, and we observed the good biomass growth, and we have collected those cells, and we employed different catalysts for getting this fame content, and we have gone for the GCMS analysis to identify whatever the fatty acid methyl esters is recovered from the microalgae by employing these are the by employing these conditions. So after that, we also synthesized iron nanoparticles from the moringa leaf, and we synthesized and we characterized through FTIR and EDAX and SEM also, and we found that this iron nanoparticle, what we have synthesized from the moringa leaves, and we have synthesized biochar from the dried leaves, and iron nanoparticles, commercially available iron nanoparticles are also compared, and we found that the iron nanoparticles which we have used for this fame recovery means fatty acid methyl recovery, it's nothing but the biodiesel, and compared with the acid catalyst, for example here, somewhat increased amount or slightly increased amount of this fame means especially C14 and C16 we have got, but not much significant differences has been observed in this case, particularly the brown algae. But in the case of brown green algae, we have got a significant production or yield of this fame while employing different kinds of nanoparticles. Then again, we synthesized the bio nano catalyst from sargas, and this is another kind of seaweeds. And the lipid obtained from this Dictyococcus microalgae, we studied the growth kinetics, and we have employed the bio nano particles which is obtained from the sargassum. We recovered some amount of fame, and we found that this is the conventional transesterification. This is fame profile of this the Dictyococcus. Both the things are conventional transesterification, and finally we employed this iron nanoparticles, and we characterized the iron nanoparticles from the sargassum species, and we found that these are the characteristics of this iron nanoparticles which is synthesized from sargassum species. And we found that this is an interesting result, actually, that before previous slides what I have shown, this is conventional catalyst, meaning acid catalyst we have employed, and we have obtained the fame quantity, and this one is this is the fame profile of the same lipid which is obtained from different microalgae. But only thing is, the catalyst what we have synthesized is nano. So nano catalyst. So we have got a good amount of fame while employing this nano catalyst, iron nano catalyst from the sargassum species seaweeds. This is the seaweed. We have synthesized the iron nanoparticles, and we have employed for the fame recovery. So we have got a fame. This is acid catalyst control. So here we can see the difference in fame. So finally, we found that the transesterification, the whole cell transesterification using this nanoparticle have yielded a good amount of saturated fatty acid along with the fuel properties. These are the fuel properties according to the American standards and European standard, ASTM and European standard. It was the properties which we have obtained from the Coelacella biomass and Dictyococcus was in accordance. Okay, and the other cyanobacteria also we have employed different kinds of catalyst, especially the titanium oxide. Here the fame yield was 36.5 plus or minus 8.3 when compared with other nanocatalyst. titanium was the best, the photocatalyst, because we thought that the titanium has been increasing the rate of efficiency of conversion of fatty acyl methyl esters from the whole cell as well as the lipids. Okay, these are different methods we have employed for the extraction of lipids: liquid nitrogen, ultrasonication, and microwave. So we have found that ultrasonication has yielded more amount of lipid. That lipid was employed for the transesterification reaction by employing different kinds of catalysts, and we found that among the different nanocatalysts, titanium oxide has yielded a very good amount of fame. This is biodiesel. This is in the biochemically. This is the fatty acid methyl esters, and this is the byproduct crude glycerol we have obtained. Apart from that, the nanocatalysts are also employed for value-added products, nothing but the pigments, especially carotenoids. We know that the source of beta-carotenoids is obtained from carrot, pumpkin, and sweet potato, spinach, and the other algae, Dunaliella salina. This is microalgae. Okay, so the sample we have collected from the Tyahamseri Ramnad, and we quantified. Simply, we just extract the pigment, and we quantified there are the carotenoid pigments were there. Then we isolated and we purified the colony in our lab, and simultaneously we went to salt pan in near Tuticorin area, and we isolated the colonies microalgae. This is another kind of pigment accumulated cells, and these are different types of Dunaliella. When they are in vegetative stage, they will not accumulate this carotenoid. When they are in stress, they may accumulate this carotenoids. So where the nanoparticles will play a role in the extraction of this pigments. Okay. Actually, so these are the cells are showing the completely carotenoids accumulated stage. Here some of the cells are started to accumulate, and some of the cells remain in vegetative stage. They are green in cells. In large scale production, people are using this raised-waste pond for the cultivation of this algae for pigment accumulation. They are in vegetative stage, means the young stage. When they are undergone for the pigment accumulation, they will become red. And after that, we have to harvest the cells, and we have to extract the cells for the beta carotene purification. So here we have used the nanoparticles, the metallic nanoparticle we have used here, the TiO2, and TiO2. Why we have used this TiO2? Numerous marine algae and other freshwater algae have been studied for the effect of TiO2, and there they have found that some of the reactive oxygen species can be generated when we are employing these nanoparticles. So at that time, what may happen? This nanoparticles may increase or induce the cells to undergo the stress, and simultaneously that organisms can able to synthesize the beta carotene accumulation. And on the other hand, the TiO2 nanoparticles, which has the photolytic catalytic with increased surface area, and they may trap more amount of light, which is obtained from the sunlight, and it can be transferred to the cells by the presence of TiO2 in the media, and thereby they will be facilitating the accumulation of carotenoid production. So that is the reason we have employed this TiO2 for the accumulation of carotenoid as a value-added compound from microalgae. We have employed different conditions to accumulate more amount of carotenoids, and to the media, this is the control media, wherein you can see the cells are green in color. Where we have employed the high salinity and TiO2, the cells are in stress and they started to synthesize. They started to synthesize the carotenoid. That is the reason why the cells have become orange in color. And this is the condition wherein we have employed only nitrogen starvation and high salinity. And this is a microscopic observation of the pigmented cells collected from different condition: normal cells and cells wherein nitrogen starvation and salinity, and cells wherein nitrogen starvation, saline, and TiO2 at different time intervals like 10th day, 20th day, and 30th day. And this 30th day, you can see in TiO2 treatment, the cell volume become large and size is also large, and the accumulated pigment is also very large. That means the TiO2 has influenced the cells to accumulate more amount of carotenoids. You can see the graph actually, and the cells were grown in two different conditions actually. When the cells are cultivated in indoor condition, means in the lab controlled conditions, and the cells are grown in outdoor condition, means there is no physical control. The cells were exposed to direct sunlight and and the whatever the atmospheric temperature was applied to the cells, and we found that the cells grown in outdoor condition as well as the indoor condition, the cells were employed with the TaO2 has given the total carotenoids or has been increased by the action of TaO2. And similarly, we found that the same chemical stress outdoor conditions, we found that maximum amount of lipid content and lipid productivity were also induced, not only the pigment. Then we have used iron nanoparticles for the cells which is grown in lab conditions, and we have synthesized the iron nanoparticles, and we employed this iron nanoparticles for biomass productivity, lipid content and lipid productivity. This is control wherein we didn't employ this iron nanoparticle, but in the case of cells were treated with this iron nanoparticles at different concentration has given increased amount of lipid content and lipid productivity also. So by the way, we conclude that definitely the nanoparticles, especially iron nanoparticles and TaO2, has an influence over for lipid accumulation process as well as the pigment accumulation. And finally, we just characterized the pigments which were accumulated by the influence of TaO2 in M60 cells, means a different type of algae. And we quantified the carotenoids based on the peak area of the HPLC of the carotenoids which is purified from the algal cells. And this is the TLC, the thin layer chromatography of pigments which were obtained from the M60 cells. Here you can see the white marked lanes are indicating the pigments, beta carotenoids, which were treated with TaO2, and the cells were grown at a high temperature, means the outdoor condition, more than 50 degrees centigrade. The cells started to synthesize more amount of pigment in addition with the TaO2. So here you can see the difference between the cells were grown in nitrogen starvation saline, and TaO2 has given increased yield, but totally yield, the zeaxanthin concentration is more. Then iron nanoparticle, especially the cells were treated with iron nanoparticles, and this is the lipid separation of lipids. You can see here there is no visible difference between the treated cells. Then after that, we have gone for the quantification by HPLC, and we found that the beta carotene compared with control, the iron nanoparticle treated cells have shown good amount of beta carotene, especially in the beta carotene, lutein and astaxanthin, zeaxanthin. So all the pigments, the different category of carotenoids, different types of carotenoids has been improved when the cells were treated with iron nanoparticles. So this is the TLC of separation of the pigments when treated with salinity, and this is a lipid. So these are the some of the publications out of from our research. I just showing one or two publications here. Okay, so that's all about my talk. If you have any doubt, you can ask. Whatever the data I have shown here, some detailed information about my data is purely performed in our lab, and our scholars have finished their work. They are the really working horses. They have created or they have generated these many data, and without them I can't definitely gone for these many publications and patents. And this is Mr. Jawahar, Dr. Jawahar. Now he is working as a research scientist in USA. He has done biodiesel production from cyanobacteria. And this is Dr. Karthava. Now she is working as a DST in Sphere faculty in Tamil Nadu Agriculture University, Coimbatore. She worked in a green microalgae for biodiesel production as well as value added products. And this is Dr. Angela Lindsay. She is an editor now in Elsevier Journal in Bangalore. She worked on microbial fuel cell from algae. And this is Dr. Shakambari. She worked on the bioactive compounds from algae, and now she is working on Samarnath Biotech Company at Bangalore. This is Dr. Shamir. He is also working in Hyderabad Biotech Company. He also worked in bioactive compounds for non-communicable disease, especially for cancer. And he is a research scientist now at Karnataka. And this is Dr. Venkatesh. Now he is working as assistant professor in Anja College. This is my accountant. So without them, definitely I won't be succeeded. Today I am standing before you with a very good amount of publication patterns and the projects with your contributions only. So I must thank my beloved scholars and other supporters, especially my university has provided a very good amount of infrastructure and all support for going for nice direction, especially in the field of renewable energy research. Thank you so much, and thank you so much for the organizing committee for giving me an opportunity to share my research data to the participants. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for excellent and informative talk. Okay, participants, you are free to ask questions now. Is the method cost effective?
Yes, of course. That is the reason why we have chosen the waste as the source for the synthesis of nanoparticles. And we are in the process of analyzing, going for what is it? LCE analysis, life cycle analysis. It would be cost effective.
Can you please explain what are the possible applications of nanocatalysts?
What are the possible application of nanocatalyst here? Only we have employed nanocatalyst in two way actually. And I have focused here only the transesterification, means the conversion of lipid into FAME, fatty acid methyl esters conversion. It's nothing but the body cell. In order to get more amount of fatty acid methyl esters recovery, actually when we employed starting days, we have employed only the acid, especially the hydrochloric acid, as the catalyst for the recovery of FAME. During that time, we have obtained only 60% to 70% of FAME recovery. When we started to employ this nanocatalyst, we have obtained saturated fatty acid, especially SFA, from the FAME, more than 90% we have recovered. So just we have got more than 90%, so we started to synthesize different nanocatalysts from the different biological sources, especially from the waste we are focusing, because we have to generate wealth from the waste. Okay. And the other on the other hand, we have employed this nano particle as a stress factor for the growth of microalgae as well as for the accumulation of lipid. So while we are growing this algae, we have added some different types of nanoparticles to induce the stress. So whenever the cells are in stress conditions, they naturally they will undergo for fatty acid synthesis. So we have employed. They are the results are in the pipeline. We need to go for publications.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of the physics department, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the honorable delegate who blessed us with her presence and took out valuable time of her busy schedule. I may like to express a sincere thanks to Dr. Varalakshmi for giving an excellent coverage to nanocatalyst for biodiesel production from microalgae. From this, she explained application of nanocatalyst, nanocatalyst used in biodiesel production, etc. So I must mention about deep sense of appreciation for Dr. Varalakshmi for this part. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.